regular Pleasant Ridge City Commission meeting of Tuesday, May 12th, 2015 to order. Do we stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Amy, may you call the roll, please?
Commissioner Foreman?
Here.
Commissioner Krzyjak?
Here.
Commissioner Perry?
Here.
Commissioner Scott?
Here.
Mayor Metzger?
Here. Okay, the first item on the agenda is a presentation from Robert Gibbs. Did you want to set it up, Jim? Anything?
Yes, Bob is here tonight to give us an update on what is cooking in the Woodward 696 study, specifically for Pleasant Ridge. The study area went from the south end of the Woodward underpass or ditch to the north end, so basically from Oakland Park, Sylvan, up to Lincoln in Royal Oak and Huntington Woods. So he's here to give us an update on what the recommendations are for us. Also, Thursday night at 6 o'clock at the Community Center is the broad, open public presentation of the final recommendations that'll be for the entire study area. So that'll be broader and deeper than I think tonight Bob goes. But there's some exciting stuff in here. And with that, I would turn it over to Bob to give us the update.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Mayor. And our plan builds on an earlier plan that was started for complete streets for Woodward Avenue from the river all the way up to Pontiac. And the complete streets calls for a bus rapid transit system, a BRT, as you probably know, going mostly down the center of Woodward Avenue, except where the underpass is. And we were sponsored by yourselves, Huntington Woods, Royal Oak, and the Woodward Action. Avenue Action Committee. This is our planning team. We brought in engineers from Colorado and from New York and from Washington, D.C. and around the country. And MISHTA was very helpful. MISHTA supported us. We held a little planning charrette in the Detroit Zoo. The zoo was very generous in supporting us. And just some basic background numbers. Oh, this is Woodward Avenue from Pontiac to the river, and there's about a half a million people that live within 2 miles of this corridor. 10% of all of Michigan's residents live within cities located along Woodward Avenue, and 5% of the state's population lives within 2 miles of Woodward Avenue. So it is really the state's primary avenue and corridor. Also, if you took all of these cities' populations, it would still be less than the people that live within 2 miles of Woodward Avenue. And Woodward Avenue was designed as one of four avenues for suburban Detroit, for the greater Detroit area, and it was always deemed as the most important and prominent avenue. And all of the avenues, Gratiot, Michigan Avenue, Woodward Avenue, all terminated at the old City Hall. Which avenues do? Avenues terminate at civic buildings. And so Detroit was laid out by Judge Woodward to do that. We think Woodward Avenue could return back to being a grand avenue like you see around the world. And we think it could be lined with proper design. It actually could be lined someday with shops and restaurants again and be a very walkable, multimodal place. When the 8 Mile overpass was designed, there was a similar overpass considered for 10 Mile and Woodward, but MDOT, I think, had a lot of foresight at the time of, instead of building the overpass, they built an underpass. And even though the underpass isn't great, it would have been, it's a lot better than had they built an overpass. These are being built all over Florida and all over the Southeast, and these immediately destroy property values when they're constructed. That being said, the underpass really isn't, we think, the long range, the best and highest use for this piece of real estate. And we are recommending that someday the underpass be removed and Woodward Avenue be raised again. One of the shortcomings of the overpass is it hurts commerce on both sides of Woodward Avenue, and it eats up a lot of real estate. These four lanes of traffic require another four lanes of unused real estate for pullover and distress lanes for traffic. So if you just removed the underpass you would pick up four, we could pick up four more lanes, which could be used for bikes, for a bike trail or pedestrian usage. The underpass has hurt commerce along Woodward Avenue. We met with a number of business owners that said this, and for example, you have a Burger King that closed, which is highly unusual to have a Burger King go out of business, but I think that fell victim to the underpass. There is a walk score, there is a rating system now for how walkable places are from 1 to 100. And real estate developers right now are locating in places with high walk scores. And I don't remember what your walk score is. Seems you're in the 80s, aren't you?
Yeah, it depends on where you're in time, but yeah. In the 80s.
Yeah. In the 80s at High Point. That's very high. Birmingham has a walk score of about 84, for example. Petoskey has a perfect walk score of about 100. And you have the classic American walkable neighborhoods. And studies show that these home values are worth a lot more when people can walk to places. There's fewer mortgage defaults. Millennials like right now moving to places where they can walk to or ride bikes. And there was a recent study that said if you live within 1,000 feet or so of a bike lane, your house on average is worth $9,000 more, for example. We are proposing a separated or protected bike lane along Woodward Avenue on both the east and west side. We think that there should be a protected bike lane all up and down Woodward from Pontiac to the river. There is a prototype being built right now along Palmer Park that will be built this summer. We're phasing that in with the plan we did for Palmer Park. If you just looked at another way of looking at the population, this is the rough study area that you hired us to look at. There's about 42,000 people that live within this study area, 20,000 housing units, and there's retail spending of $500 million a year inside the study area. So this intersection is a very, very valuable intersection with a lot of people living here. I just saw a statistic this morning that half of all Americans live within a 5-minute bike ride of where they work. So for example, if you could have this bike lane installed here, you've got 40,000 people that live within 2 miles of it. This is our actual study area. This is the zoo, Pleasant Ridge, here. This is Royal Oak, of course, and this is 696. We looked at about a dozen specific study areas. And tonight I'm just going to focus on the ones in Pleasant Ridge. To put numbers in perspective, this is downtown Birmingham. This is Maple or 15 Mile Road. It has about 23,000 cars per day on Maple Road here, and it's only two narrow lanes with two parking lanes. This is very common. As a rule of thumb, you can accommodate 10,000 cars per day per lane, as a rule of thumb. There are a number of sections that are designed pretty well for cars. They're wide, but they're very unwalkable for pedestrians. And we have a number of recommendations, including just saw cutting to make it look like a sidewalk, to maybe painting it green, putting in barriers and cones, and someday covering this area. This is Main Street. This is Royal Oak up there, and covering it someday with a pathway. We are calling for a number of bicycle paths that will be painted on, and we're calling for a number of markings to narrow the lane width, still to accommodate the traffic volumes that you have, but to encourage the cars to go slower and to balance the playing field between cars and pedestrians and bicyclists. And we have short-term, mid-term, and long-range recommendations, and all of our recommendations go from short-term, such as just putting up barrels to see if you can get rid of a lane of traffic, to painting stripes, to then long-term actually moving the curb out. So here you can see we would test it with barrels and paint, and then in the long run, if that's successful, then we'd like to see the curb actually moved out to make this more walkable and landscaped. This is Main Street, this is 696, and this is Woodward. This is the zoo parking garage. So there's a number of areas that we're calling for improvements. This little park we're calling for someday for a building to be built there. One of the things that the residents told us when we were working here is that people that live in this neighborhood have a hard time getting to the community center. And you can see why. If you live here, you have to go down to Oakland Park, cross where the signal is, and go back. Before the underpass was built, these streets used to be very crossable, and you could walk back and forth. Someday, if the underpass is removed, these can be reconnected. We're hoping that people that live up here will be able to have a more safe connection and just cross right along here to get into the community center. So we're proposing a number of pedestrian improvements along there to help link the east and west side of Pleasant Ridge together. This is a one intersection. This is Main Street. This is Woodward Avenue. This is one intersection that everybody said they felt very safe crossing. And you can see why. This was designed almost as a geometry of the Indianapolis 500. It's a very high-speed turning corner. And pedestrians told us that when they cross here, they feel threatened because they have to look over their shoulder and they can't anticipate these cars, which are going 40 or 50 miles an hour. So we're recommending narrowing that down to one lane for the short-term improvement, tightening the radius so that cars actually have to put on their brakes and slow down a little bit, improving the pedestrian crosswalk here. We think we can remove a lane there, and then we can pick up this real estate so that pedestrians have a safer crossing here and here. This lane is really not used very often. We think you can remove traffic from that lane, which will make it much more safer for pedestrians to walk across there. So this is a short-term improvement. Yes?
Would you mind clarifying why, when you remove a lane, does it make it more safe?
Because we think the cars will go slower, and it sets back this traffic. It gives another 8 or 10 foot barrier between the traffic and the sidewalk. So there's a perception that if the car loses control, or if it's a major truck, that you're not right next to the truck. So it's a perception of safety and a reality of safety.
Thank you.
And then we're recommending, for example, here a bike lane. This is looking north, that's the zoo, a bike lane. And we just have a number of recommendations. We will be handing out printed copies of this when we're finished next week. This is the long-term recommendation. This is Main Street again. This is Woodward Avenue. In the long term, we'd rather actually have this constructed so that cars have to slow down and make a hard right turn before they go north on Main Street. We're also recommending that this be two-way so that cars coming from Royal Oak can go south and then turn into Woodward Avenue. This shows the ditch being removed entirely, but you could still have this if the underpass were there. Cars could do this and then turn around and go that way. This is sort of like the Adams and Woodward intersection up in Birmingham, for example. So this gives the pedestrian a much safer crossing. Cars can still be accommodated. They can go slower. And then here we're removing one lane of traffic and putting in parallel parking. And then we're hoping that buildings will be built here, and here in the long run. And that's what this intersection could look like. Mm-hmm. It's a triangular piece of property that your park is, and that builds very memorable landmark buildings called Flatiron Buildings, a triangular building, and you have a perfect site to build a landmark type building like this. So this was a proposal that DPZ Architects did for Birmingham 20 years ago. And you can see how this would be Woodward Avenue. You could have cafes and dining, and then this would be Main Street right here. So we'd like to see that happen in the long run. This is what it would look like in the long run. You'd have a hard right turn for traffic to go there. Southbound traffic could go here. People that are living in this neighborhood right now, they could still use this alley, sort of this back doorway that they use. We're keeping the alley there, but they could also come south on Main Street and make an easy left turn into the neighborhood there. And then this is park right now that we would like to see developed as cafes and buildings. And then along Woodward Avenue, we're proposing what's known as a slip street. It's a street with parallel cars parked on it. And then we have just a lots of recommendations. This is a short term. This is the zoo. This is, I think I'm looking south here, aren't I, Jim?
East. You're looking west.
Looking west, you're right, okay.
Looking west.
I'm looking west. This is 696 over here. So here we would like to try removing the lane by removing the by putting barrels there for one season, then painting it with stripes, and then if that works, permanently moving the curb, putting street trees here. And you can see how much safer it would be for the pedestrian if the traffic was out here rather than right there. It'd be much more walkable. I think it would help link together the east and west side of Pleasant Ridge and make it much safer. And then we're calling for this better pedestrian striping everywhere for the crosswalks. You can see this kind of striping isn't as effective. And this is something that you could do right away, is improve the striping, make it safer pedestrian striping. And then someday, if you're inclined to do so, we'd like to see a building on the park. This is of course Main Street. This is the crossing, and we're calling for striping. This is would still be a wide lane, so fat trucks could turn and make this turn. People that are doing this and going into this neighborhood would still be allowed to do that, of course. But we're narrowing this by one lane, and then the crossing improvements that we're recommending. This would make it a lot safer for people that are walking into downtown Royal Oak. And then in the long run, we'd like to see the overpass built with buildings. This has been done in other parts of the country where they sell or lease and they build buildings right over the overpass. This is one in Columbus, Ohio, where you have a very similar overpass as 696. The city, working with their Department of Transportation, built buildings and shops so that you have an almost seamless connection from one half of the overpass to the other half. And this is something that's very realistic that you could do here. So this is the zoo right here. We found that this lane gets very little usage, and we think you could remove that lane with paint. You know, if a car was really intending to, they could of course drive over the paint and make that turn, but we think you could remove it. And these are some examples. This is looking southeast. This is 696. This is Pleasant Ridge. I'm standing in the zoo parking garage. And so this, you can see how by removing that lane and painting it, it greatly shortens the crossing that pedestrians have to do. It removes one complete lane of traffic. We feel that there should be civic art, regionally sized and scaled grand civic art on the overpass of 696 and Woodward. You see that in a lot of cities around the country. This is just a placeholder of what we'd like the civic art to look like. And this is a crossing again where this is Pleasant Ridge. This is the community center, I think, over here somewhere. I'm standing in the zoo looking south. And this is a very unpleasant crossing right here. And we think it's realistic. We've had traffic engineers look at this. It's realistic to put a bike lane there to remove a lane and to make this safer to cross. The Oakland Park Boulevard is where a lot of people are crossing. A lot of families are crossing from the east to west side in Pleasant Ridge. And we're recommending just bolder pedestrian crossings, a bike lane through here. And then we're recommending, this is called a bicycle box, where the cars pull back a little bit and stop a little bit short of the curb right here, so that when they're making a right turn here, if there's a bicyclist, they can have a better chance of seeing the bicyclist. It's a lot safer for bikes to do this. It's called a bicycle box. This is Oakland Park. There's a tree in the way that we're going to save. If the tree weren't there, we could make it a little smoother to get across, but we're not going to advocate cutting the tree down. And we have plans for Ridge Road. I understand a car was clocked going on Ridge Road at some god awful number?
72.
72 miles an hour. Of course, it's a very walkable area. We have three alternatives for making it safer for pedestrians on Ridge Road. One is just narrowing, putting in a 4-foot paint stripe on either side. One is putting in on one, putting a bicycle lane on one side, grouping the cars together. But in either case, we think the lanes should be narrowed on Ridge Road, and there should be a bicycle lane or some kind of pedestrian improvement there. These are sections for Woodward Avenue with the BRT in the middle. We found just by, we think you could help commerce just by putting a sign, a local sign, so that people could see if they want to shop locally, they could do so on the avenue. We're recommending street trees be replanted along Woodward Avenue. It's been shown that street trees slow traffic speeds down, and it makes pedestrians feel safer. It creates an sort of the illusion of there being a barrier between you and the cars. And it also improves real estate value. I've seen that street trees improve real estate value by about 8 or 9% on homes when you have street trees, especially if they're planted between the curb and the sidewalk. One of our ideas was to take the BRT and instead of putting the BRT here, to actually bolt on a BRT lane and have a cantilevered out over the side. MDOT actually liked this idea, and it solves a lot of problems. It lets us have a nice bicycle lane. And MDOT actually said, why not even, instead of putting it there, maybe we could even just put one right down the middle. And I don't know how far that's going to go or not, but it was pretty interesting. It really makes for a much safer pedestrian bicycle lane on both sides if we could do something like that. So our recommendation is to have a two-way bike lane going up and down Woodward all the way from the river up to Pontiac. We think it would be used by a lot of families and a lot of commuters. There's a lot of people using it right now, and we think it could be a regional bicycle way. So that's our short version of our recommendations. Thursday night, we're going to present the overall and some new drawings that we haven't shown yet.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
Very good. Yeah.
Any questions?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Gibbs, for all the hard work that you and your company have done in the service of this vision. I think everyone in this community is really excited about the potential there, and having your professional eye and really helps people visualize what can be there. And so I think this is very helpful for our community, and I appreciate taking the time this evening to do that. I know you guys have been working on this for a while, and you've had visioning sessions with community residents. Mm-hmm. I know the commission participated in a charrette with your group, and we appreciate some of the input that you took in that regard. I just have a few just broad questions. I have had conversations with residents who, as you mentioned, have difficulty crossing either from the west to the east or east to the west. And the Sylvan, Oakland Park, Woodward crossing, I know that you've identified ways that we can make that safer. I do like the potential at the 696 on the northern end of town, shorting the crossing distances for families, not only going to the community center, but ultimately to the zoo. That's all welcome. I have had residents and myself, I've actually envisioned, and there has been discussion over the years of a pedestrian overpass,
right.
A bridge of sorts or some sort of connector, actually bypassing all of Woodward. You see it, there's a few examples on 696 as you work your way east.
Right.
There's some communities that are connected in that way. There's a few on 75, who have the pedestrian bridges.
Right.
I was just wondering if your group had looked at the potential there, or how you feel, what's your general kind of feeling about those in this situation or in general?
That's a great question. We actually did look at the plausibility of putting a pedestrian bridge at the north end.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, maybe, you know, just south of 696. I don't know the street name, but we could connect two streets together.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, somebody pulled out of a drawer a proposal for that. It was actually proposed by MDOT when they built the underpass.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't go anywhere. I think Pleasant Ridge or somebody shot it down. But I think that's a viable option.
Mm-hmm.
It's expensive. You'd have to have an elevator on one side. But if the underpass is there, I think that's a viable option that should be kept alive, should
okay.
be considered. Yeah, I really do. It's such a severe crossing.
Right. Well, we've talked, and I know my big concern mm-hmm. in the charrette that I attended was, you know, having young children, mm-hmm. wanting them to interact with families on the west side and ride their bikes to the pool, and that's not really something that I felt comfortable. My oldest
right.
son, you know, now he's creeping into teenage years. It's, you know, a little more feasible,
mm-hmm.
but my still younger ones, it would be out of the question, you know.
Sure.
And, you know, there's other families who have mentioned that over the course of when you mentioned 696 Woodward improvements. That's something that people always
yeah.
Throw out there. So I appreciate, you know, you weighing
yeah.
in on that. I was really struck, and this is part of the innovation that I appreciate you bringing to the conversation, is the idea of buildings on the triangle. I think
mm-hmm.
that's something maybe the planning department maybe, or the planning commission is maybe toyed around with, you know, developing that triangle maybe over the years. I would ask you, I know you spend a lot of time with these maps, like the parking. I know you mentioned the slip street parking
mm-hmm.
would be an applicable, you know, parking solution there. We have parking difficulties in other parts of the city. Do you think that developing that corner there, we could manage the parking requirements?
We looked at the parking, and I think the buildings are so small that with the added on-street parking on Main Street, and I think it's solvable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, would it handle a restaurant that is a big signature restaurant where everybody goes to there on Friday night? Maybe not.
Right.
But most commercial uses, yes, it would handle.
Cool. Yeah. And I know the big goal of this plan is to fill in the overpass, you know, bring Woodward back up to a, you know, a
mm-hmm.
more humane level. I know Jim has talked about this, and we've been, you know, kind of briefed about that would be something that MDOT would look at years down the line.
Right.
Like, the what, in your professional opinion, would be a reasonable estimate for that to be accomplished?
I don't know the years, but at someday the underpass will have to be rebuilt. Concrete only lasts so long. I think it's about 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
So when you reach that point where, like, 375 has to be rebuilt in Detroit right now by Eastern Market.
Yeah.
There's a tipping point where it can cost the same or less to remove it and build it at grade.
Mm-hmm.
So when the underpass becomes obsolete, I really think as a community you should advocate for it to be removed.
Okay.
I think that's a long range thing to do. And I think the traffic numbers, our experts that we brought in says that it's plausible to remove it. Now, it's going to require a lot more study, but it is plausible. And I really think you need to advocate, because there's so many upsides to removing it.
Mm-hmm.
You can have a grand avenue again. You can have shops that can be more walkable. You can connect the two halves of your community.
Right.
There's just so many upsides to doing it. I wouldn't recommend doing it until the underpass becomes obsolete. But someday, someone's going to say, we've got to spend $50 million with either rebuilding something that we don't like
mm-hmm.
or tearing it out and building something that adds value to real estate.
Great. And one last question. I know you mentioned about the separated and protected bike lanes, and that there was going to be a prototype in Palmer Park this
mm-hmm.
summer.
Mm-hmm.
Is that going to be along Woodward, or is that going to, that will be along?
It's right on Woodward, right on the west side of Woodward, right at Palmer Park.
Okay.
Yeah, and that we're working with them right now. We did a master plan, community service master plan for Palmer Park last year.
Uh-huh.
The landscape architects did that in Michigan. And so right now we're working with them to mesh our plan with that. Yeah, I think that's funded. I think that's ready to go.
So if our residents were to see that this summer and potentially use that, would that be indicative of what you had envisioned for the entirety of Woodward?
It's pretty close, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yes. Yeah, it's set, the millennials really love bike lanes. And, you know, there's no downside to it. Home property values go way up. People can commute to work on bikes, and it's just so many pluses for it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, question. So, Bob, one thing I've heard from some residents is that you can add the bike lanes, but nobody would use them. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's true or not. Where have you seen examples of a similar situation to this where there's no such thing currently, they're put in, and what has the result been? Have they been heavily used afterward? Has the culture changed as a result of that?
Right. It's so counterintuitive to say put in bike lanes. Everyone says they won't be used, but they've been used heavily in San Diego, in Portland, in Seattle, in New York, in Washington, D.C., in Minneapolis. And so there's lots of climates similar to this where they've been used. But they have to be properly designed, and you have to balance traffic versus the bicyclist. But that's what everyone always says. They just built a giant bike system in Atlanta. Everybody said, well, we're in the South. We don't ride bikes. We drive pickup trucks, and you know, we'll never use them. And now they're expanding it as rapidly as they can, and it's been wildly successful. And the property values, all the naysayers that said, I don't want it in my backyard, are now seeing their home values greatly escalate because they're close to this. It's really a win-win, but it takes a big vision to do it. But remember, you got 5% of the state's population living along Woodward Avenue, and you know, it's pretty amazing. If there's a place to do it, this is the place to do it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. It's been an honor to work with you.
Well, likewise. Hopefully, and hopefully we'll have a big crowd on Thursday.
Yeah, you had a big one last time.
I know. We had one.
We couldn't believe it.
So.
All right, well, I'll see you some of you Thursday night. Good night.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Okay, the next item on the agenda is public discussion. Items not on the agenda. And now we, the man in the green coat.
Mayor and Council, Ted Zachary from 68 Devonshire.
That's good.
I have two more of Ted's terrific tips. A little continuation. We have an environmental meeting on the 20th. It's gardening with Michigan native plants and natural mulches. It can be seen in the Ridger, page 13. And it's May 20th, 6:30 at Four Ridge. The gardener, Diane Gregory, will speak about using Michigan native plants and natural mulches to establish butterfly habits and benefit the environment. And I like Mr. Gibbs' visual aids, but I have more something smaller, but I thought I'd pass that along to the audience over here. It's May 20th, a Wednesday, at 6:30 at Four Ridge. So this is one of my terrific tips. My second terrific tip is to attend the Plant Exchange. It's called the PR Plant Exchange. A little visual aid here for you, for some of the people who don't know about the Plant Exchange. It's going to be Saturday, May 30th, from 9 o'clock to 11. And it's been around for a long time. I think most of the people like to bring a plant, drop it off, and if they see another plant, they take it. For example, somebody brings a plant to the Plant Exchange Saturday, May 30th, and another person comes and brings a plant and says, oh, I like that lamb's tongue. So they take it, and the other person takes another one. No money is involved, so that's good. And we have a new item. Instead of annuals, that we're going to have perennials. Wait, did I say that right? This is a butternut squash. So this is new. And So we're all I'm excited about that because I'll get tomato plants, some other squashes, and that's terrific. And I have a, not a visual aid, but something humorous. I'll end up with something humorous. The Plant Exchange may have annual meetings, but should they be called perennial meetings? Thank you, thank you. Any questions? Hope to see you Wednesday the 20th and the 30th with your plant. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ted.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Ted. You're welcome.
Any other items for public discussion? I mean, after Ted, nobody wants to get up, right? All right, we'll move on to the next governmental reports. Start with the police. Yeah? Oh, well, we do have.
That's all right.
I defer.
You defer?
I'm the rookie guy. I defer.
All right. Mr. Wittenberg, please. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Good to see everyone. I actually don't have much to discuss. Wanted to come thank everyone. We had our coffee hour here in Pleasant Ridge, and it was a tremendous success. Far and away the largest we've had so far. Close to 50 people were there. So love to see that. I mean, an engaged community, that's for sure. Main issues that we talked about there, auto no fault, the reform that's being attempted in Lansing, the budget, and unfortunately they add they try to say that they're adding money equitably to schools, and they're giving $299 per pupil for charter schools and online schools, and only $25 for public schools. So that was something I you know, voted against, as well as the $134 million building that the Senate, the senators are moving into or trying to move into in Lansing, which is it's completely wrong. I mean, you know, everyone's pinching their pennies, yet these people in the Senate are going to go buy a $134 million building. And they actually didn't even check the prices with, you know, comparables in the area. They're paying well over what it should cost, or what it, you know, if they were going to buy a comparable building in the area. So a lot of things that that I was opposed to, and so we voted against the budget. And then I'm trying to think of what else we discussed in the coffee hours. Anyone's concerns, you know, people had some issues and some questions, and again, encourage anyone to reach out to me at any time. Anything we can do to help, please let me know. But just again, wanted to come thank everyone for promoting it, for helping us host it here, and we'll continue to do that. Again, every month we hold coffee hours throughout the district. Hopefully we'll be back here in Pleasant Ridge in the next few months. So, but I'll let you know.
I assume you weren't surprised by Proposal 1?
I was not surprised. You know, I was supporting it. Full disclosure, one of the few, obviously, after the 80-20 trouncing. And again, part of it was, you know, I was a fan of most of the things that were put in there. And it was a compromise. It was, you know, Republicans and Democrats actually came together. That's how this got to the ballot. But I guess, you know, obviously wasn't to the liking of the voters. The alternatives, nothing has actually been presented as of yet. I have some things that I think would be a possible solution, things that we can work on that will, you know, what I said is that we can't cut from our local communities, we can't cut from our schools, can't cut from community health budget, things like that. So we'll kind of wait and see. We're hoping that the Republicans will actually work with the Democrats to get a solution.
It was interesting, Huntington Woods almost passed it.
Yeah.
It's the closest of any, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, so no, this, and again, like I said, everyone gets out to vote here in the 27th district, and specifically here, Pleasant Ridge, Huntington Woods. People get out to vote, which I love to see. That's for sure, because you have to have a voice in the process. So, any other questions? Anything else that?
I'll go.
Yeah, Robert, thank you for hosting that coffee, and I'm really glad to hear so many people came out. To engage with you, because I think it's really important, you know, to engage with our representatives in Lansing. I did hear something that was worrisome, and maybe you can help me fill in some of my my gaps in my understanding. There was legislation that was being introduced. I think there was a Republican sponsor, and it was going to limit local requirements for fair wages or limit what communities could enact as far as paying employees or contractors livable wages, which I felt was bad enough. But then reading further into it, I learned that it could potentially undermine local communities' ability to pass non-discrimination ordinances. Pleasant Ridge is one of 38 communities across the state. I think Michigan has the most local communities who have passed such ordinance against discrimination against in hiring, employment, residency, and against gays and lesbians in the community. Short of amending the Elliott Larson Act to, you know, protect our LGBT neighbors, you know, these communities have been passing these local ordinances. This new proposal that was put forth, I don't know if you know anything about it or any chance that it would have of passing and how it would affect our human rights ordinance that we have on the books here in Pleasant Ridge.
Well, I haven't had a chance to look at it. I know that this is something that they're trying to push through. Mm-hmm. This went on the agenda as of, I don't know, 2 or 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon for today.
Mm-hmm.
Usually they give you, you know, a week notice or whatever they do. I think they actually have to give you 18 hours, whatever the number, I don't know the exact number, but mm-hmm. they gave the absolute minimum that they had to give, knowing that they wanted to kind of push this through. What I did hear about it is it's exactly what you said, but it's the prevailing wage, minimum wage, LGBT, you know, any kind of local ordinances for,
right.
for human rights ordinances, things like that. And so, yeah, something that I absolutely oppose. Our Democratic, as a caucus, we haven't taken an official position, but more than likely we will come out as a caucus to oppose this as well. And I hope that there are actually some moderates on the other side that realize that this will be detrimental, that this is bad for our local communities. I'm not on the committee, so I didn't even hear about this until this morning. So I haven't had a chance to really read up on it. But from, you know, talking to some of my colleagues that served on the committee, you know, that they said that this is just bad. Community benefits agreements.
Mm-hmm.
So we had there was testimony taken today. Former representative, you know, Rashida Tlaib, who was a representative, she came to oppose this bill. Stephanie Chang, who's one of my colleagues in the House, opposed this bill. The person who actually, I wasn't there, but someone I talked to who was there said the person who actually sponsored the bill, they asked some questions and he didn't even know some of the details. So my guess is, you know, this was part of their platform, part of their agenda that they want to push through, and that's what they're trying to do. So,
well,
chances, to be honest with you, chances are likely. I mean, if they're bringing it up, then they're doing that because it's something they want to do and something
mm-hmm.
they think they can do. But we'll see. I'll keep you posted on it for
Thank
sure.
Thank you. No, because it's very concerning. I know, as far as local control and issues of, you know, regarding communities establishing these ordinances, you know, it's disheartening to hear Lansing, you know, in the one hand preach, you know, you guys need to be more, solvent financially and you need to take care of your house. And then when we attempt, you know, to enact ordinances to, you know, complete protections for our community,
yep.
they want to restrict our ability to do that, which, I feel is very unfortunate. So I personally, you know, appreciate, you know, the effort that you would take in, making sure that, that kind of effort is
I'm with you on this one. You have my support on this, and I will fight however I can and do what we can to try to defeat this.
Thanks.
So, and again, preaching to the choir with this group here, but we really, you know, as this starts to progress a little bit, I'll come back and tell you and tell everyone at home to remind their friends and family that are in areas where their representative might be on the other side
mm-hmm.
and tell them why this is important, why they need to oppose this and how it will harm the communities rather than help the communities. So, and that's the best way to really spread that message. And that's something we saw with Auto No Fault. I can't even tell you, I mean, through all the issues, you know, since it started in January, and of all the issues that we've gone through, auto no-fault. I've received more emails, calls, letters than every other issue that's come through us combined. I mean, thousands and thousands of email. Part of it is because I was on the insurance committee, but even within the district, just getting emails from everyone here in the district, it's unbelievable. And so, and I know a lot of reps throughout the state are, you know, have been getting some kind of correspondence. And I think it's working, to be honest with you. You know, it passed through our committee barely, but we kind of knew that was the case. They wouldn't have brought it up if they didn't think they could get out of committee, but they haven't brought it to the House floor yet because they don't have the votes. Mm-hmm. So that's something, you know, whenever there's an issue that that's that important that we really, really need to work against, then we have to get as many people involved as possible and make our voices heard. So, and you have my support on this.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor? Something for Representative Winberg. Just a reminder, May 16th, the evening of May 16th, we'll be having the Pleasant Ridge Foundation auction over at Fort Ridge. I know you were there last year.
Yep.
Want to make sure you're very connected. Want to be sure
you actually need to, I need to get my ticket. I don't know if I can go online.
You
have one, all right. Okay, good.
So that's all. I didn't have a good segue, but I wanted to remind you.
I will, absolutely. Yeah. No, I had a blast there last year. I have another event. But I think what I'm going to do is probably go the other end first and then come here so I can spend the rest of the evening here. I did have a lot of fun, and so I can close it out here.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
She's all ready for you.
Yeah. Yeah. Look
just
at that.
Just holding it right there.
Yeah.
Get into my two.
Right. Okay. No, not for now. I'll let you know.
Anything else?
Yeah.
Anything else?
We have the auction booklet in case.
Okay. Okay. Should I grab this now? I don't want to.
Yeah, just go grab it.
Okay. Okay.
Hold it up for the camera.
There's a lot of great items there that you'll have time to peruse.
Yeah.
Okay.
So just get back to the camera.
Get me later.
Sure. There you go.
Okay.
It's all yours.
Thank you.
Hey.
Thank you. Yeah.
You just cleaned the table. That'll,
absolutely.
That'll keep it down.
Right. Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay, there was some battling who lost or won. Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Ladies first.
Schools.
Wow. Okay. Well, before Ted slips out the door, I think I need him to hear this good piece of news. Ferndale Schools, Ted, don't leave. We have 5 schools that have been recognized as being green schools. And so those are Roosevelt, JFK, Coolidge, Ferndale Middle School, and Ferndale High School. And they are all being recognized at the Oakland County, Michigan Green Schools Award Ceremony. And so I just wanted you to hear that before you left us, Ted. Nothing like calling somebody out on their exit, right? So following on the footsteps of our wonderful public servant who does exemplify all these things, I want to give hope that we will get even more people like that in Lansing someday. And remind everybody that our annual John F. Kennedy Awards are coming up. And so this is where we really get to celebrate the students that we are raising within our school system and those who demonstrate not just outstanding scholarship, but we're looking for kids who exemplify goals of public education, including things like integrity, maturity, industry, scholarship, citizenship, athletic and or cultural contributions. And people are very supportive within their school and community. And so we all know these wonderful students who live in our community. If anybody would like to nominate somebody, please do go on to our website. And it is right there off the main site. So you can find it at ferndaleschools.org and then /JFK Award. So please take the time to go there and nominate that outstanding student that you're thinking of right now, because I know each of you knows one of our fabulous Eagles. So many great things are happening for our young children, and we're already seeing more and more young families coming back into our schools, which I just am so excited about. Thank you again for having us at your recent event in Pleasant Ridge. We had 4 more children sign up to come into our Little Eagles program from that. And we also have been having lots of kids showing interest in our summer playgroup. So if anybody wants more information about Eagles or about the playgroups, please, please, please go on our website. That's always a great resource for information. And continuing the theme of our little children, We do have some kindergarten information nights coming up, and these are on May 21st from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock, and that's going to be at JFK. I really do count on word of mouth for this, because we all know that there's nothing more valuable than a neighbor telling you to show up. So May 21st, 6 to 8 o'clock, and then again on May 28th from 6 to 8 o'clock at Roosevelt. So both are from 6 to 8. First one, May 21st at JFK. Second one, May 28th at Roosevelt. Please tell your neighbors. We want those little kids in our classrooms. I know this is one that was interesting to Commissioner Foreman. Our Montessori teacher has been hired, and so we have announced the new hire to be Amy Pomerow. And so people who are wanting to meet her, she will be introduced to the community, and there's a meet and greet in conjunction with the kindergarten information night that I was just mentioning. So people who are wanting to meet her, please show up on May 28th, and the time again was 6 to 8 at Roosevelt. Just really making sure we get our people there. So please do come and meet Mrs. Geiser Pomerow there and tour the classrooms. We also would like to, of course, recognize the MP Robotics team. I remember we were last time speaking about that. So thanks to everybody who did go on and donate. They were able to make it to the championships, and they were the best. They were they set their personal best of 238 and were within the top 20% in the world. So I just think that that's absolutely outstanding that they were there competing against Israel, the Netherlands, Australia, China, Turkey, and were within the top 20%, which of course is no surprise when we have this district that's building new fabulous programs like Cambridge and really trying to become a district of pride. Congratulations to the 45 Ferndale Middle School students who were inducted into the Lauren Sophia chapter of the National Junior Honor Society. Many of us in town remember Mr. Sophia because he has been a longtime community member. So that happened on April 23rd, and there are also a total number of 65 students in that organization. So just another example of how many high achieving students we have in our school district and the wonderful things happening. So any questions?
Mary, I have a quick question. Mm-hmm. Regarding the Montessori program, I know there was a large number of families interested in that last time we spoke about it. That's for the 15-16 school year. Is that full at this point? Or is there still room for additional students?
Oh, no, come on and apply, and yes, absolutely. There's we always have room for you in the Ferndale schools, believe me. There's always room for you in the Ferndale schools.
And that program begins, is it at first grade?
First through third.
First through third. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. All right, I was trying to be speedy. I don't want to keep these gentlemen waiting too long.
Thank you. Thanks, Karen. Okay, now, gentlemen, look at it. All right. You could do it together.
Eight.
I can't see them.
So I'll go first. Good evening. I don't have very much. Just general stuff that's going on. As you know or been aware, our city, as well as like Royal Oak, Ferndale, and other surrounding communities, have been the victims of much graffiti and tagging and spray paint and stuff, including the dog park. E-Prize, railroad cars parked back there. One of our midnight officers the other day happened to come across two individuals. He was able to apprehend one. He's been responsible for what we believe many of the taggings all over the place. He was a 22-year-old white male who lives in Oak Park who's been charged and is pending prosecution, trying to link him to other ones. He wasn't talking much, but he did have evidence on his phone. They're proud of what they
yes,
do, so they took pictures of it, and it's going to come back to bite them. The other thing, officers this morning, two of us stopped at 3 a.m. this morning, just turning off of Millington, a car in front of them, wasn't driving right, made a stop. Actually pulled over in the parking lot here. Five individuals out of Inkster, they found a loaded .45 handgun tucked between the seats. So know that even though they don't live in this community, bad people drive through or pass through our community like that every day. We're out here doing our job, and fortunately nobody got hurt, and the gun was taken off the street, and that's pending prosecution. Having said that, with all the recent events lately on TV, we're bombarded with police work has come front and center on the media. Know that we're aware of it. We watch intently the coverage of events, hoping to learn, to do things better. Know that we're curious about the people in our own community. We're interested in their burdens, their trials, their fears, their objectives, and their hopes to learn so we don't have the conflicts that these other communities are having throughout our nation. We want to continue to learn and adapt to be more helpful and responsible in order to help things just go right. And we're constantly reviewing by training our own policies and procedures how effective and helpful these changes have been and could be, and how to further improve our service. So that's all. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Your Honor, Commission, I don't have a lot tonight, but what I do have is kind of critically important. Recently, there's been changes in fire science, how fire burns. Between NIST, the National Institute for Standards and Technology, and Underwriters Laboratory, or UL, you see that on all your electronic devices, have run through grants through FEMA and the Assistance of Firefighter Granting Program, burns of old construction versus new construction. In today's world, plastics. This podium, the carpet, chairs, all covered with plastics, and basically that is a solidified form of petroleum or gasoline. So when these things catch fire, fire spreads and moves fast. We're talking doubling in size about every 11 seconds, and within 8 minutes can consume most normal homes. So in the old days, the smoke detector in your bedroom or one outside the hall protecting three, those things are gone. You practically need a smoke alarm in every room and hallway of the house. And the National Fire Protection Association doesn't think that's going to be enough to alarm you in some situations, the way your house is built. One of the things the younger generations are going to, and some of us older generation people are looking at, is open floor plans, removing doors, and having an open, more commonized feel to the home. And fire likes that too. It's a very open, fast-moving thing. So open floor plans, I would get to the point where I recommend that people love open floor plans. Consider installing a home sprinkling system. Home sprinklers versus commercial sprinklers. Commercial sprinklers try and save property. Home sprinklers try and save lives. It buys you a way out. And that's really what a fire extinguisher should be kept for in your bedroom and that. Now that takes us to bedroom doors. What can we do? So my thoughts started going when I was doing all this new fire science to teach the guys on how we're attacking fires. What about you, the public? What do you need to do? Bedroom doors aren't for privacy. They are for smoke and fire protection and have been since the 1900s. So if you got them, close them. The kids are afraid, teach them not to be afraid. Because what it can stop is a lot more scarier than what they think closing the door could do to them. Also teach them how to get out and feel the door for heat and go to a window. The next thing, even if you do have a fire in your home and you open a door and discover one, shut the door. If you can't, shut the window. Don't try and fight the fire. Get out of the building, call us, and let us get a handle on it. Before we open up a building now, we like to get everything ready and the water to put on it, then open the doors and windows and go put it out. If you open them too quick, it creates what we call flow paths and starts a nice draft, just like you'd want to do in your fireplace or your wood burner to get a perfect burning situation. That's what opening things up. So the old days of everyone opening it to see if they could save anyone. So current fire science tells us, leave it all closed, get ready and go in, and we can control the flow path. The chances are we're buying time for any victims laying there. When we open it all up, we're taking the heat from 8 to 1200 degrees up here and pushing it right down to the floor. And that's proven fact by NIST and UL, and they both work together in harmony. So my suggestion to the public, and we're going to be putting a big campaign together from our fire marshals division with his inspectors, is to shut all your doors, put in extra smoke alarms. They're not that expensive. Make sure you change them every 10 years, even if you think they're working fine. If you can go for a longer battery, great. But you probably should check it for battery power and that about every time we change our clocks. Spring forward, fall back. And those are excellent recommendations. Most people think it won't happen to me. When it does, those people tell us, I never thought it would happen to me, but oh my God. because they do move fast. So it's really important that everyone understands the new fire sciences, that fires are moving extremely fast, and we need to help you protect yourselves, and then we can come and help protect and put the fire out.
Have you developed materials?
We're developing materials. Yeah, we've gone through. We're trying to do a whole program, including how many candle burners we have in here. My wife is one of them, constantly in the wrong place in that. So if you have a candle, if it's 6 inches tall, you should have at least it on an 18-inch plate. So if it falls over, nothing can spill out or go to cause you a fire in your home. Or buy hurricane candle burners. Just because a candle comes in glass doesn't mean that glass is fire and crack proof. It just means it's in glass. Mostly to melt, make it smell good and look cool. Better not to burn candles at all. NFPA and FEMA recommend if it's a power outage and that, do not burn live candles. Use LEDs, and we have all kinds of lighting now that's cheap and easy and last a long time with the same batteries. In the old days, it burn up pretty quick. So if you're going to burn candles, don't use fans above the candle. Don't set them near paper. And obviously animals or anything that can knock them off, because a lot of house fires are caused by candles. Most common place is the kitchen. Most common fire starts in the kitchen, and then candles are one of the secondary big burners. So we're trying to print up and get all these things together and start a massive information campaign.
Cool.
That's it.
Lots of pictures.
I'm big on that.
Dumb it down.
Big on pictures. Yeah. Just sticks with your head, you know. It's worth a thousand words.
You know. Thank you. Thanks. All right. I think we've done that. All right. The next item is City Commission Liaison Reports. Commissioner Foreman, Committee Liaison.
Yes, I'd like to start by thanking Commissioner Scott for attending the most recent school board meeting in my absence, taking very good notes for me. I have some items I'd like to share. The first, we have two exchange student opportunities available for residents for the upcoming school year, 2015-2016. First is with a group called Youth for Understanding. There's a contact named Barb Kilka. Her phone number is 248-932-0811. And you can find more information on the web at yfu-usa.org. The second opportunity is from a group called Educatius International. The contact name is Teresa Ledesma. Her phone number is 248-670-4030. The next item has to do with an FEF fundraiser, Ferndale Education Foundation. This is up on the screen right there. That's the flyer. It's the Four Kids Classic. It's, thank you, Jim. It's Saturday, June 20th, starting at 8 a.m. at Sanctuary Lake Golf Course in Troy. $100 per golfer, or $125 if you register after May 31st. $35 for dinner. Includes golf, continental breakfast, hot dog at the turn, and various contests. Dinner and awards starting at 1 p.m. at the Bosco in Ferndale. And for registration information, you go to two different places. First, you can find Ferndale Education Foundation on Facebook just by searching those words. Or you can contact Kathleen Latosh at klatosch at gmail.com. Phone number 248-807-1557. I'm not a golfer. My dad was an avid golfer, and I think he turned me against it because he golfs so much, and I'm very bad at golfing. But there are lots of golfers out there, so I think if you like golf, you will like this event. Again, it's June 20th, and the early bird registration period ends May 31st. And finally, the big news of the district that you probably have not heard about yet. Ferndale Schools will have a new superintendent for one day. And it's PR resident, GFK fifth grader Kirsten Zwiebelman. She will be Ferndale School Superintendent for the day. We don't know the date yet, but she is going to take control of the district and make some changes. I know she will make every minute count, and she already has some very specific ideas for what she wants to accomplish in her day. For example, where my son Nicholas would likely have wanted to implement a dancing policy every 15 minutes, or 15 minutes for every 2 hours of classroom time, whichever, he'd probably go every 15 minutes. Kirsten, I believe, would prefer to see a healthier lunch option on the menu. So for example, eliminate Doritos and put something more healthy in there. Or my daughter Chantal would have liked to see a stable built on the playground for ponies and unicorns. I think that Kirsten wants to look at beefing up the training of the school staff on food allergy precautions and emergencies. So Kirsten is taking her day as superintendent very seriously, and I'm looking forward to hearing all about it. Finally, few upcoming notable events. The next school board meeting is at 7 p.m. on May 18th at Harding. May 21st, kindergarten information night at JFK from 6 to 8 p.m. And as Karen Toomey mentioned, May 28th, the kindergarten information night at Roosevelt from 6 to 8 p.m. where you can meet the new Montessori teacher. And finally, May 22nd and May 25th, no school in recognition of Memorial Day. That's it for me.
Thank you so much. Commissioner Perry, Planning and DDA.
Thank you. The Planning and DDA, Planning Commission and DDA held their April meeting on Monday, May 4th. The Planning Commission had a special presentation by Mr. Gibbs. They saw the presentation he had this evening and were able to ask him questions and had a really great dialogue. The DDA approved their budget for the 2015-2016 fiscal year. Some key projects in their upcoming budget year are contributing funds to the alley projects that are going on the east side right now, Complete Streets pilot projects that will greatly benefit the PR businesses, a lot of what Mr. Gibbs talked about tonight, and then also really focusing on some community promotion ideas that will help our downtown businesses. The next Planning Commission meeting and DDA meeting will be on Monday, June 22nd. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Scott's Historical Commission.
Yeah, two things to mark on your calendar. The first is this Saturday, May 16th, our historical museum will be open from 10 to noon. It's actually being hosted by Carol Zupan and John Wright this weekend. If you've never seen the historical museum, it's got a lot of good history inside of it. It's good to stop by and see some of the detail about our city's past. And then the big news is the Home and Garden Tour, which is on June 6th. So if you've not already planned to attend, it's a great event to see what people are doing to their yards. And it's almost a good before and after, because people have been doing a lot of improvements and things to their homes. And you'll see some of that during the Home and Garden Tour on June 6th. And we also have our meetings the first Wednesday of nearly every month. So mark your calendars for the first Wednesday of every month, nearly every month, and check our city's website for that. And again, I'll just give a little plug for the Saturday. If you've not planned to attend, it's a great event coming up on Saturday. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Did you want to tell us any more about that event?
Oh, no, we'll get
right.
to it.
Okay. Commissioner Krizyak, the Recreation Commission.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to remind residents of the upcoming Memorial Day holiday and the Memorial Day parade. Kids can participate in this year's parade as they did last year. We'll be prepping their bikes on the preceding Saturday, May 23rd, at the community center at 11 a.m. We'll have a bike decorating event. The kids can come and apply streamers, stickers, balloons, get geared up for Monday's participation in the Memorial Day parade. If you can't make the bike decorating event on Saturday at 11, please feel free to pull into the line with your bike on the Memorial Day parade. Attendance at Saturday's bike decorating is not necessary if you still want to join us on Monday. So it's a lot of fun. Scott wanted me to remind everyone that the pass cards are available for the Gainsborough shelter. This was a great improvement, and I've spoken to many residents who've already utilized the restrooms at the shelter. We've had some residents, John and Lyle Ulinski, have set up a lending library in the shelter. It's really coming together nicely down there. If you haven't gotten your card yet, you can get yours at the community center. Just get signed up, and each household will be issued one card. And another reminder, the pool is set to open on Friday, May 22nd. Hopefully the weather gets a little warmer before then, but I know everyone's anxiously awaiting the opening of the pool. And finally, I just want to bring residents up to date. As part of the preparations for the Gainsborough Improvement Project, the city recently sent out bids for design and construction management. We had several firms reply with outstanding proposals. There was a selection committee that was assigned to look over the proposals, and that committee has narrowed the field down to four firms. The committee will be interviewing them at City Hall on Tuesday, June 2nd. The public is welcome to attend. The four finalists are Harley Ellis Devereaux, Living Lab, McKenna, and Design Team Plus. And I know myself and the mayor on the selection committee, and we're very impressed with the proposals. These are the firms that the city will partner with to bring the Gainsborough project to completion. There's a lot of interesting vision. We saw some vision earlier for Woodward Avenue. Some of the same exciting concepts are being considered for Gainsborough Park. So if you're interested in that process, those interviews will be taking place on Tuesday, June 2nd at City Hall. And that's all I have, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anything else? All right. The next item is consideration of the following consent agenda. We have basically seven routine items to consider, and before we move for approval, I'd like to just select one of those, just because we had the discussion prior to the commission meeting with our chief of police and talked a lot about issues around the police forces across the country and some of the high-profile cases that we've heard about what was going on in Pleasant Ridge. He gave us a brief report on that. And I just wanted to read that a proclamation that is being made for police, on the police nationally and locally. And so just let me read this out. Whereas the Congress of the United States of America has designated the week of May 15th to be dedicated as National Police Week, and May 15th of each year to be Police Memorial Day. And whereas law enforcement officers are our guardian of life and property, defenders of the individual right to be free men, warriors in the war against crime, and dedicated to the preservation of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And whereas the City of Pleasant Ridge desires to honor the valor, service, and dedication of its own police officers. And whereas it is known that every 2 days an American police officer will be killed in the line of duty somewhere in the United States, and more than 100 officers will be seriously assaulted in the performance of their duties. Now, therefore, as evidence of our sincere appreciation for our police officers and all others, the mayor and city commissioner are proud to proclaim the week of May 10th to May 16th, 2015, as Police Week in the City of Pleasant Ridge, and May 15th, 2015, as Police Memorial Day. Further, the City of Pleasant Ridge hereby joins with other communities across this nation to honor all peace officers for their dedicated service, and call upon all our citizens to make every effort to express their thanks to our men and women who make it possible for us to leave our homes and family in safety each day and return knowing they are protected by men and women willing to sacrifice their lives if necessary to guard our loved ones, property, and government against all who would violate the law. One of the most important things that this community has always made us aware of in surveys and everything else is the importance of having our own police force. And I do believe we have one of the best, and I feel it's very important that we honor them. So with that, I will move to have approval of the consent agenda.
Your Honor, I move that the consent agenda be approved as recommended.
Is there support?
A second.
Can we have a vote?
Commissioner Foreman?
Yes.
Commissioner Perry?
Yes.
Commissioner Kuziak?
Yes.
Commissioner Scott?
Yes.
Mayor Metzger?
Yes. Motion carries. The next item is consideration of the agreement between Plante Moran and the City of Pleasant Ridge for financial accounting services effective July 1st, 2015.
Yes, thank you. You have a memo in your packet. We have before us a proposed renewal for the Plante Moran contract, including a 2.5% fee increase this year, or the year beginning July 1, 2015. And then in subsequent years, there's an inflation rate multiplier, which would increase their contract pegged to inflation. We've been happy with Plante Moran services. We're still paying Plante Moran less than we paid the fully loaded cost of a full-time treasurer. Mm-hmm. So we have saved ourselves money compared to the past, and we get good service from them. So we are recommending approving the contract.
Is there a motion to approve?
Mayor,
go ahead.
Sure.
Yes.
Mayor, I move that the agreement with Plante Moran for financial accounting services effective July 1, 2015 be approved and that city manager be authorized to sign the agreement.
Is there support?
I support.
Are there any discussion, questions?
Yes, Mayor, if I could. Jim, would you mind talking about how this would, not foreseeing any problem, but if either party needed to terminate the agreement, what would the process be for that?
There's a notice requirement, and I'm not sure offhand what that is. That would be in the initial agreement.
Mm-hmm.
But we just have to serve notice.
Okay.
And then it would be terminated.
Okay. Again, I've had no issues dealing with Plante Moran over the years. They've been very helpful and very professional, and I've been very satisfied with their services. As you say, if we were to employ our own treasurer to do the duties that Plante Moran does, it would be, in your estimation, more costly than what this contract calls for.
Yes. When you factor in everything that goes along with it, insurance, you know, benefits, salary, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? May we take a vote?
Commissioner Scott?
Yes.
Commissioner Perry?
Yes.
Commissioner Foreman?
Yes.
Commissioner Krzyzewski?
Yes.
Mayor Metzger?
Yes. Motion carries. Next item is establishing public hearings on June 9th, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. to solicit public comments on the following. An ordinance to amend Chapter 74 Utilities of the Pleasant Ridge City Code. The proposed fiscal year 2015-16 millage rates. And the proposed fiscal year 2015-16 combined city budget. Jim, did you want to make any comments?
Not this time. We're just setting the public hearing, so we'll have more information about this, the budget and the water rate proposal at the June meeting. But the information is in the City Commission packet available online, and the proposed budget is also on the homepage of the city's website. So I encourage anyone with interest to review that to see what the plan is for the coming year.
And just as a statement, I think that it's an enjoyable, I mean, it's an interesting document in and of itself, and I think even if you just read the introductory chapter without getting into all the tables, I think it's a very informative on our budget, you know, how the budget has stood over the last 10 to 15 years, ideas about assessments, where our money comes from, and how the revenue sharing and a number of other things have affected that over time. I think you did a great job. And I love charts and graphs, so some really interesting charts and graphs. But a lot more information and a lot more historical information that allows people to see really what's been going on over at least the last 10 years, isn't it?
Yeah, going back to 1985 in a lot of cases.
In some cases, yeah, even better. Mm-hmm. So it's up there, and I encourage people to take a look. Do I have a motion to establish the public hearings?
Mayor, I move that a public hearing be established for Tuesday, June 9th, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. to solicit public comments on the proposed ordinance to amend Chapter 74, Utilities of the Pleasant Ridge City Code, the proposed fiscal year 2015-2016 millage rates, and the proposed fiscal year 2015-2016 combined city budgets.
Is there support?
A second.
Is there any discussion?
Yes, Mayor. I know the public hearing will involve a discussion of the proposed water ordinance amendment. Could you speak briefly, I know you've covered this in the past, but the changes that are set, that are proposed for the water rates and their potential to increase or decrease what our residents are going to be paying for water, in particular in the coming year?
Sure. Well, the headline news is that everybody will pay less for water, assuming you use the same amount of water that's coming year that you used last year. You'll pay less for that water in the coming year. We're changing the structure for how the water rate is right now. We have a completely rate-based billing structure. We're moving to a ready-to-serve charge where there'll be a fixed fee, $28.40 every bill, and then the consumption will be applied to whatever you use. And the reason for that is to maintain a minimum level of income to the city. We have to maintain and operate the pipes in the ground. So you know, even if you never turn your water on, we have to maintain the system. In the past, we generated a minimum level of revenue by doing a minimum bill. So that's why if you used very little water, you still paid $158 every utility bill every 3 months, because whether you used 0.2 or 0.8 MCF, you were billed for 0.9. That was the minimum bill. So we're doing away with the minimum bill, changing to the flat fee plus, you're only billed for whatever you use. The rate is going down from $125.36 per 1,000 cubic feet, and that is going down to $101.55. So based on consumption, you'll be paying less that way. The garbage pickup fees are going down as well. So that's a guaranteed savings of about $80 for every resident on garbage pickup fees. So we've very assiduously worked to make sure that we come up with a rate structure that does save everybody money this year, even though wholesale charges are going up double-digit percentages for what we pay for wholesale water. We are able to accomplish that.
Great. I appreciate you laying that out for some residents. I know people were eager to really dig into how the water rates were going to change. I know you've done it in multiple instances, including a town hall that I felt was very informative. So I appreciate you again going over it for our residents.
Pleasure.
Any other? May we take a vote,
please? Commissioner Foreman?
Yes.
Commissioner Perry?
Yes.
Commissioner Krzyzak?
Yes.
Commissioner Scott?
Yes.
Mayor Metzger?
Yes. Motion is carried. Okay, we move to the city manager's report.
Thank you. In case you hadn't heard, the City of Pleasant Ridge, along with Huntington Woods and I believe Farmington Hills, received some recognition for recycling. This is from the state. They had a little party over in Kalamazoo to hand out the awards, and we weren't able to send anybody because they conveniently had that on Election Day. And being a very small staff, Election Day around here is kind of all hands on deck just to keep the ship afloat. So we weren't able to send anyone to Kalamazoo to get our recognition on stage from the governor, but it's the thought that counts. Huntington Woods had a 54.8% recycling rate, and we had a 54.2% recycling rate.
Wow.
So I'm confident when we get our single stream recycling bins, the big ones at Huntington Woods pays four times more than we pay for recycling, by the way. We will certainly trounce them the next time those numbers come up. The alley construction update. I don't know if you've been out by the alleys, but they were finishing up the concrete pours today. So spoke with our engineers, and the alleys should be open for business by the end of next week. Don't hold me to that. It could be the beginning of the week afterwards, but we're making great progress. If you do go out there, you'll notice that the alleys south of Kensington look like normal concrete. They look like you'd expect. In the alley between 10 Mile and Kensington, kind of looks like a Rice Krispie treat when you look at the pavement. And the reason for that, of course, is because it's pervious pavement. We saved ourselves some money by not putting in all the drainage structures underneath and all the underground work. Instead, we're testing this out as a pilot project as a way of testing pervious pavement. So that allows the water to drain right into the ground through the pavement. But of course, it looks kind of like a Rice Krispie treat because it's loose. It's bound together. It's been used for about 10 years now, so there's a track record for it. We're trying it out here for the first time. So interested to see how that works. But it just looks a little jarring when you're used to seeing how concrete's normally poured. I know Scott came in today and was having a hard time with it. But
excuse me, Jim, could I ask a quick question about that?
Absolutely.
Is the longevity of that comparable to standard concrete, and does the freezing in a winter affect it with water getting in and then expansion?
I mean, there is that chance, but the water freezing in there will either come out the top or get pushed down in the ground. It has a 10-year track record now that has been used very commonly in Michigan through Michigan winters. So the winter issues are not really a concern. The long-term longevity, we don't know because it's got a 10-year track record. The good news is it's half of a block for us, so we're kind of treating it like a pilot project. It's not a huge cost if we have to go back and try something else in the future, but returns have been good so far on that product.
When I talk with engineers, they seem to think that it will have the same type of longevity. It can hold the same amount of weight. They do the same amount of tests on it. So, you know, they think it's something that is going to last. And it just, like I said, it looks a little strange, but
it could help reduce our runoff.
Yeah, there's no runoff. It's flat. I mean, that was when they put the grade down. There's no grade. It's flat minus like a little, you know, it's about an inch for every 70 feet instead of, you know, a foot for every 70 feet. And when I talked with the contractor, he said you can open up a fire hydrant on it and the water just goes through it. So.
And it really does solve a problem, because that alley, that stretch of alley, why it was always in such bad shape is because there was no drainage. So all of those giant potholes that would form there was just because the water would sit and it would break it up over time. So it'll certainly be better than what we have. Yeah, that's no question about that.
Glad we're trying it. Thank you.
Yeah. My brain turned off here. Let me turn it back on for a second.
While you're doing that, when they're finished, they're going to be starting in Oxford shortly thereafter, right?
Oxford will be starting at the end of June.
Okay.
So I think they're going to go do other things for a few weeks and then come back to us. Because that was one of the specifications in the contract, that they don't start until school is out.
Okay.
Towards the end of June. We also recently did some routine maintenance on our streets. Hopefully you've noticed that all of the potholes in town are gone. We used the spray patching method again, where they spray down an adhesive and then a liquid asphalt, and it plugs the potholes in a way that's much more durable than cold patch. So we did that again this year. We spent about a third of what we spent last year on that product. Hopefully, by keeping on top of potholes that form with this product that lasts for 3 to 5 or more years, we can prolong the life of our streets in a more quality manner than we have maybe in the past. Because you throw cold patch in a hole and you have to keep throwing more and more and more in, it just disappears. So we've been very happy with that product so far. We'll continue to use that every spring. And finally, one thing that I would like to mention that I think that staff will be bringing forward to you in the coming months is an ordinance for discussion on some of these things that show up in front yards. We know that we had the pod that sat in a front yard for months and months and months. On a lot of our construction sites, we have porta-johns that are sort of placed in the front yard, and then we have to look at them in the front yard, and we don't like it, but right now we don't have anything to enforce on that. So that's something we're going to be looking at bringing forward, is a construction and temporary objects in the front yard to just try to maintain the aesthetics around here, because we know it's a problem, but we just have limited tools to address it right now. So stay on the lookout for something in the coming months. And that's all I have, unless anyone has any questions on anything.
Any questions? Okay. Thanks, Jim. Let's move on to other business. I open the floor.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, I should have mentioned this during the recreation liaison report, but I wanted to emphasize my appreciation for the foundation. I know we had the Gainsborough Park opening a few weeks ago. Scott really put on a great day. The mayor was there. The foundation was there. It was really a great example of the impact that the foundation has in our community. And again, I want to thank them. My children really, really loved the park and had a great day. And it's really a testament to what the community can do when they come together through the foundation. And if people want to see more of that, I would really encourage you to support the auction this coming Saturday, because what we're seeing happen in Gainsborough is the potential of what we can do when we all come together and put money towards our community. The Gainsborough Park is really a shining example of what can happen. So, wanted to make sure I mentioned that. So, here, and then can you hold this too? Okay. And the book club selection, I think this is actually the second selection that we've chosen, the first being Mr. John Gallagher's book, Reimagining Detroit, that features our esteemed mayor. We should maybe change the name of the book club. But
that's why I keep pushing you toward nonfiction.
Yes, yes. No, this the selection for June, at our last meeting, we decided to alter our schedule slightly, and June's book, actually May's book, but we'll push it to June 1st because we realized that the last Monday in May is the holiday. But if you'd like to join us to discuss Detroit City is the Place to Be, we'll be discussing that book at the Gainsborough Shelter at 7 o'clock on Monday, June 1st, if you can make it. If you've read the book, please join us. If you haven't read the book, please join us. If you have reminiscences.
That's good enough.
Yeah. About your upbringing in Detroit, the book really focuses on a past and a future of what Detroit was and what Detroit can be. Very similar to the topic we discussed around Mr. Gallagher's book. So if you'd like to join us, please feel welcome. And Monday, June 1st at the shelter at 7 o'clock. Thank you.
Nothing else to hold. Anyone else?
Mayor?
Yes. Thank you.
Did you want to talk about the WA3 on Saturday?
Oh, on
this Saturday? May.
You mean there's something else going
there
on
is.
Saturday?
Wow. On May 16th at from 9 a.m. till noon. Mm-hmm. There's a cleanup day down at the Ford Highland Park plant. And everyone is welcome. Just come and bring your good heavy shoes and gloves and whatever, and help clean up. I think a lot of the cleanup's outside, so it won't be getting into any of the interior stuff. But so they will just be from 9 till noon, and they will greatly appreciate any help everybody can bring. And then also another WA3 fundraiser is the 4th annual Sunflower Gardens on Woodward, which a couple of wonderful members of the Woodward Avenue Action Association, Norm Silk and his partner Dale Morgan, who own Blossoms, they help get sunflowers as well as trees planted along Woodward in Palmer Park, and it's just beautiful. And if you know, they accept and appreciate donations at all levels. But if you donate $75 or more, you're invited to the garden party at their wonderful home, the Turkle House in Palmer Woods, which is Detroit's only Frank Lloyd Wright residence, and it has been restored beautifully. Their gardens are something that are of a true inspiration. So that party will be on Wednesday, June 10th from 6 to 8 p.m. for a $75 or more donation, and it's a great cause as well as it's a really lovely event. That's all. Thanks.
Mr. Mayor, question for Commissioner Perry.
Yeah.
The event you discussed, the cleanup effort on
yes.
Saturday,
yeah.
That's from 9 to 12?
Yeah.
It takes place where?
Ford Highland Park, which is right there. It's the old Highland Park Ford Model T plant, which is right, south of 6.
Okay.
Near that CVS.
So there would be time for someone to come to the historical museum.
Yes.
And then perhaps put their gloves on, head down there, clean some stuff up, come home, take a shower,
yes.
Maybe rest, relax a bit, and then head over to the auction later that evening.
I think they could.
Which ends at 11 p.m. So you'd
right.
have plenty of time to
so
have
it starts
a full,
at 5:30.
Wonderful day.
Right.
Okay. Inside and
that's
outside.
That's a great idea.
Ridge.
What?
Thank you.
What a day.
What a day.
What a day.
Wow.
Is there anything? Is there anything else?
I have something.
Yes.
I wanted to announce that qualifying petitions for the Office of City Commissioner are now available in my office, the City Clerk's office. They are due July 21st by 4 o'clock. So anyone interested in running for that office, City Commissioner, needs to come in and pick up a qualifying petition with me. It'll be voted on November 3rd. But again, those petitions are due June 21st. There are two seats that are expiring this year, Commissioner Perry and Commissioner Krzyzewski. So, again, I have one person that's already pulled a petition, so they're out there gathering their signatures.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
Question for Amy.
Sorry.
Regarding the election day activities we just had, do you have numbers on a percentage of voter turnout, and how did it compare with similar elections in the past?
We had a 38% turnout, and for an off election, which is what the May election would be for us, mm-hmm. it was one of our highest turnouts.
Okay. That's great.
Thank you.
But we didn't beat Huntington.
Again.
Yeah. Not even close. Just,
what was
so
their percentage?
They had 45.
Yeah.
So I just, luckily I never said anything. I learned my lesson,
no,
I'm not going after it. So, any more plugs? Nothing, I think we got it.
Yeah.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved, or yes.
Oh, support?
Yes.
We are adjourned.